have today Pushpamala with their presentations and then a conversation following. More than 50 group shows, over a score of solo shows in reputed galleries and museums in Austria, Bangkok, Canada, Dubai, England, Finland, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, Perth, Spain, USA, and of course India. Collections of her art in the Queensland Art Gallery, Gallery of Modern Art in Brisbane, Australia, and the Saatchi Gallery in London. The numbers and names tell a tale of achievement, glorious success, and worldwide appreciation for Bangalore-born artist Pushpamala. Tutelage under Balan Nambiar at Bangalore University in the mid-70s, and then study of sculpture at the Faculty of Fine Arts, MS Baroda, MS University Baroda, carved for Pushpamala an early interest in sculpture and narrative figuration, primarily of the female form. She ventured into the realm of photo and video performance art about a decade back, casting herself in various characters and personae, enriching autobiography with elements of surreal aesthetics and dramatics, and superimposing layers of humor, femininity, guise, and historicity onto photographic prints. Her photo romances and studio photographs move beyond the limitations of mimetic figural representation, enticing viewers through striking and elusive narratives that underscore her engagement with popular culture, post-colonial theory, and feminist historical gaze. In her ethnographic series, for example, created in collaboration with photographer Claire Arney, she becomes the subject of her own compositions, and in playfully drawing attention to the choreographed stylistics of early anthropological studies, she enacts, critiques, and subverts stereotypes of women. In another solo show, Paris Autumn, the centerpiece was a 35-minute black and white film constructed from still photographs, and she blended the presentation techniques of Indian cinema houses with comic books and European film noir. Pushpamala has recently expanded her oeuvre towards the medium of experimental short films, live performance, and sculptural tableau, bringing movement, text, and sound to her structured compositions. From her first solo exhibition at the Venkatappa Art Gallery in Bangalore in 1983, Pushpamala has come a long way. She has taught and lectured widely on arts. Many honors have been bestowed on her, including the National Award, a gold medal at the 6th New Delhi Triennial, the Charles Wallace Trust Fellowship, and the Senior Fellowship from the Indian Ministry of Human Resource Development. Her video works have been screened in film festivals from all over the world, and in 2010, she was awarded a residency to work in Paris and create a series of photographs at the legendary studio Harcourt for the exhibition Paris, Mumbai, New Delhi. The pseudo-archive, the title of Miss Pushpamala's presentation, indicates that perhaps we shall be in for a subversive treat today. Ma'am, please.
It's great to be here. Thank you for inviting me. I'd like to particularly thank Diwan Manna, who's this very enthusiastic, the most enthusiastic Lalit Kala Academy chairman in the country, I think. And I think this is a very lively, I've been hearing a lot of stories about what happens in Chandigarh. This is my first visit here, so I'm very excited about being here and seeing the city as well. What I'm doing now is, I'm going to present my recent works, the last few years, about four projects and talk a little bit about them. Just to give you a brief background of about how I work, I think there are two underlying themes or whatever directions in my work. One is a very strong feminist content, very consciously so ever since the time I was a student. I use women's subject, women's material and women's narratives in my work as a platform to look at the world. And the other thing is an interest in the idea of the nation, So you'll find these kind of things as underlying ideas of a lot of my work. I'll first talk about bit about the Mother India project that I'm doing. Actually, it's an ongoing project. I started, I've been doing it in bits and pieces because nowadays I work sort of simultaneously on different projects. And to tell you a bit about the way I work, I'm not a photographer myself. I work with photographers. Something like a film director works with a cinematographer. So what I do is I sort of work out a kind of, it's not a script, but a sort of series of scenes that I want to do. I do some reading and research and notes before I work. And also sometimes there's a lot of production work because I may make elaborate sort of painted sets and tableaus and costumes and props and so on, some of which I source from different kinds of places, borrow from friends or get from costume places. Some of them I make myself, some of them I get made. So it's quite an elaborate process, the whole thing of the production. So the production takes several months for each work, and the shoots actually are very small part of the whole process. And then again, after the shooting, I work for a long time on the editing, whether it's photography or video work. So this, as I said, one of my interests is actually looking at the idea of the nation. And I've been very interested in, since the beginning of the nationalist movement in the late 19th century, there have been many versions of Mother India symbolizing the nation. So I've been looking at them, and my original idea was to actually recreate them by playing those roles myself. But then which I've done in a sense in my earlier project called Native Women of South India, Manners and Customs, where I recreated existing images. But here what I decided to do was actually to work in different kinds of media. I worked in live performance for the first time. I've done a sculptural installation. I plan to work, do a sound work, do videos and so on. So it's going to be a very large ongoing project which is going to actually use different media. But what I don't like to just do things, going off in different directions. So what I do is, whatever I'm interested in, I try to bring it under the kind of umbrella of a particular project. So everything is very, very focused in a sense, but also in a sense very global. The artist explores the idea of the nation, performing historical images or otherwise. It's an ongoing project. This was actually done very early on in 2005. This, of course, you must be familiar with. This is Abanindranath Tagore's, the recreation of Abanindranath Tagore's Bharat Mata. So what I've done is I've got the, it's a very important historical image. Actually, Abanindranath Tagore did it when Bengal was split, but later on he made it into, he described it as Bharat Mata. And so it's a very ascetic sort of image of Bharat Mata. And of course, it's like a Vaishnava saint. It's like a Vaishnava sort of mendicant. And she is carrying various symbolic objects like, the khadi cloth, the Rudrakshamala, the wheat chaff or the rice, I think paddy, and the Vedas or something like that. So these sort of take off, this is actually a very popular kind of image of Bharat Mata, and I sort of go to bazaar photography and calendar pictures. So I take different kinds of sources and references in my work, associations. So sometimes what happens is that I use a lot of humor in my work, and certain comic elements come out of the sort of materials I use. For example, I found this papier-mâché lion in the costume place, company where I hired some of the costumes. So here it's like a kind of popular film studio, a popular street bazaar photo studio. And of course, this is the very kind of Hindutva kind of Bharat Mata, which is used in for election banners and posters and so on, with the Om flag, the Trishul and so on. This I took from a calendar picture. Well, not many people would like the heads chopped off in a picture, but this is an artist friend of mine. So one of my things is I don't use any professional actors. Obviously, I can't afford to use them, but I also like to use amateurs. I myself am an amateur, and I feel my body language is clumsy, and that adds to the to the image in some way. So I use different people, different characters in my work, and they're all friends who are actually finally very professional, and they take it very seriously and come prepared. Of course, I bone them up and I tell them what to do. I get the costumes or tell them what to get. So this is another artist friend called Umesh Madanhalli, and this is a very interesting. Calendars of Bhagat Singh were very popular at a certain point. This is reference is taken from Patricia Oberoi's collection of calendar paintings. I mean, it's not exactly recreated, but the pose I've taken. This is Bhagat Singh offering his head. There are many pictures of different national leaders offering their heads. They're very kind of slightly gory. This was done in Baroda in a workshop. It's called Motherland, Lioness and Blood, Baroda. I normally don't cut and paste, but in the last one I've used montage, and here the whole thing is a montage because I couldn't, obviously in a very short time, I couldn't sort of get the painted backdrops and all that together or create that. So this is a Ramlila backdrop that I had a picture of it that I already had, but I got the costume and got myself shot by the boy who ran the printmaking studio over there, and this is from the web, the lion and the blood splatters. This is something I'd like to talk about in some detail. This is my first live performance. It's strange that I've been doing performance since the mid-90s, but I don't like doing live performance. Actually, I'm very nervous on stage and I've got stage fright. But somehow, and in fact, I hated to be photographed as a child. But I, anything, you'll do anything for art. So I somehow got into this. When I started doing photo performance work, but it's within this studio situation or a very limited situation. But I think live performance is a very different thing altogether, where it's very raw and you're dealing very directly with a kind of live audience. It's not mediated. How this happened was actually in Bangalore, there was a very interesting artist sort of project, a one-year project in which artist called Suresh Kumar, young artist. He asked some of us to give some money, and in return, we had to give 2,000 rupees a month, and in return, we got 2 weeks of the year. He hired this hall in the center of town for 1 year from the Amateur Dramatic Society, and so in return, we got these 2 weeks. So, and either we could use it or give it to other artists to use, like young artists. Many interesting things happened over there. It was a wonderful project. So in the beginning, I was feeling lazy. Then I said, look, it's just an artist crowd. So why don't I do something different, experiment? And even if I make a fool of myself, it's just us. So I decided to do this performance. And somehow I had this idea of, I decided to connect it to the Mother India project. And I had this very strong image of myself dressed as Mother India knitting. So I rang up my, I wanted to do a collaboration, so I rang up my friend who's a Kannada poet. She's a well-known Kannada poet in Bangalore, she's my neighbor. So I said, look, Mamta, I have this image of myself as Bharat Mata knitting. So can you respond to me with either your poetry or some historical Kannada poetry about nationalism? So she said, that's very interesting, because she had done her PhD on early Kannada women writers. So she said, there is this woman called Nanjangud Thirumalamba, who is the first nationalist woman writer, first woman writer and the first poet who wrote verses on nationalism. And she had a very interesting history where she was very well known. She ran two or three journals. She was a kind of social reformist, a novelist, a poet, and many things. And but at some point, at the height of her reputation, the Kannada male literary establishment condemned her and said she was a bad writer. So she suddenly went into oblivion, and everyone thought she was dead. Till in the 1980s, the feminist Kannada writers retrieved her, found that she was alive, and celebrated her. So we sort of connected this whole story to the, you know, the women's reform was central to the nationalist movement in India. So a lot of the questions ran around women's education, widow remarriage, and so on. And there were many debates around it. So we artist Pushpamala N and poet Mamta Sagar explore the idea of freedom and captivity through the work of the first Kannada woman writer and nationalist, Nanjangud Tirumalamba. So this is the poster for the invitation for the show. So this was the stage. So what happened was that this is a Ramlila backdrop that I got from Delhi, from Chandni Chowk. And I created this very, very stylized kind of a box theater. It's a scene of a palace. So everything is very stylized. The stage and Bharat Mata is extremely stylized. The only modern, while the poet, that is Mamta, the contemporary poet, is modern. And everything is very still except the poet who moves. She brings me onto the stage. I bless the people. She leads me on and seats me there. And one very funny thing was I couldn't knit without my glasses, you know. So we sort of included it into the performance. Where she comes very ceremonially and she places the glasses on my nose. So everyone thought that was the best part of the performance. This is fantastic, you know. So then she starts walking around talking about the whole idea of Mother India and this woman representing the nation, and then goes to the story of Nanjangud Tirumalamba, and then the debates that took place in the Mysore Legislative Assembly in the late 90s and early 20th century. Mysore had one of the first or the first legislative assembly in India, and there were these hot debates going on with women also taking part about different positions on women's education and so on. In fact, Tirumalamba took a very conservative view then. She was against widow remarriage, in fact. Talks about her story and also and ends with, I think, some quotations from Nehru, who says that, look at this figure of Mother India. She is like a queen. She's so richly dressed, but India is a land of peasants and laborers, and so on. So it's a half an hour sort of performance. So all I do is I just, actually in the first performance, I was just taking out the knots from the wool, and in the second performance, we had a second performance in Delhi in Khoj, I actually knit. That's all I do. I don't even look up. There's no communication between us. And I'm a completely stylized figure, and hope you notice those false arms sticking out with the flag. So she, at the end, she, leads me out. So this is my costume. So then I developed this sculptural installation, which was, in fact, I reused the same set. So this is the installation. There are these different images of Mother India. There's Kali. I use mannequins. And I got these costumes. So there's Gomata, but a very militant one. There's a Durga kind of figure. Then there are these different, there's this Bharat Mata kind of costume. Then there's a globe. There's a kind of what is it called, gramophone, portable charkha and an hourglass. So again, I'm using in a sense this whole thing of photography, because I improvised on the spot when I was putting it together, actually. And finally, it became as if it became like a kind of group photo where all of them are posing for a photograph. You can almost imagine a kind of old camera in front, but it also has references to the Renaissance portraits, and this whole notion of you find these popes and these different sort of important figures, European figures, posing maybe with a globe or an hourglass and so on, which are like sort of symbols of time or of their dominance over the world and so on. So I'm just playing with the some of these things. I'll show you some of the photographs of the Akut set. What happened was that the Centre Pompidou Museum in Paris had this show called Paris, Bombay, Delhi in 2011, and they were sort of commissioning artists. That was for 20 Indian artists and 20 French artists taking part in the show, and the original idea was that the French artists make work about the Indian artists make work about France, and the French artists make works about India. And when the curators approached me, they already offered me an idea, a proposal which I could take up or not. But it was very interesting for me. They said there is an old studio called the Studio Arco in Paris, which was famous in the particularly in the 1950s for these Hollywood glamour portraits. And it's not the original studio now, but they still use this style. And they asked me, they said, would you like to work with them, collaborate with them? And that was because I don't know if you know my Navrasa series. I had actually worked in a Bombay studio, which was also famous for these, you know, this particular style of Hollywood glamour photographs, which uses stark sort of shadows and light and so on. So I decided to recreate some 19th century French images, commenting again, like, you know, with the female figures. These works are recreations of 19th century images shot at the Studio Arco Paris, famous for its Hollywood style portraits of film stars, looking at French history and the place of women in its culture. So one was it's very strange. I was looking through the web, and this is a very unusual thing because it has a Taj Mahal like thing in the background, but most of the, I was looking for an Orientalist painting. Normally the French Orientalist paintings are based in North Africa, which are their colonies, you know, and not something that looks Indian, but I found this, and but it's like a harem scene, and it's called The Slave and Her Slave. So I wanted to talk about this whole history of colonization and this Oriental sort of imaginary. So this is the original picture, and I recreated that in the Arco studio. So I got the sets painted, and I got the costumes made and so on. That's me as the second slave, and we hired a French actress. This is a very interesting character. There was this woman called Countess Castiglione, who was the mistress of Napoleon III. And apparently, you know, France is a very extremely sort of patriarchal society. A woman cannot be queen, but they've had a long tradition of very powerful French mistresses. So this Countess Castiglione was an Italian woman who became the mistress of Napoleon III in the late 19th century. And she acted as a kind of diplomat, and apparently she even prevented a war because she was sent to some other kind of, kingdom, and which was had these hostile intentions. And but she also had this history of getting her photographs taken by this very early French photographer called Pearson, and that both the histories interested me. And here it's very funny because I love to myself in my photographs to show the process and the behind the scenes. And what she's doing here is that thing you see at the back is actually a clamp which is used in early photography to keep the head still because it has to take a long time to photograph. And she's very playfully picked up a Victoria, a frame, and she's looking through that like a mask. And of course, that also reminded me of my Phantom Lady series. So this is a very recent work, 2012. This is a sequel to my first photo performance work, which was Phantom Lady or Kismet. You might be familiar with it. It's very widely shown. It was made in black and white and shot on the streets of Bombay. So I've been wanting to make a sequel to it, and finally I was actually asked by the cinema, by Majlis, for their Cinema City project. It's a show that's been going all around India last year about looking at Bombay like a cinema city. And they asked me to, it was very interesting for me because they would produce it. And then I said I will shoot on cinematic locations in Bombay. In the sequel to the earlier photo romance, Phantom Lady or Kismet, the Phantom Lady gets caught again in a dark web of murder, intrigue and foul play in contemporary Mumbai. While rescuing an orphan schoolgirl, she runs into the underworld and the land grab operations would stop at nothing. Turning investigator, she tracks the mystery through the principal sites of the evil operations, old film theatres, slums and new glass-faced office blocks. So they're all friends. Atul Dodiya is the chief villain, by the way. Tushar Jog is the side villain. And my friend Tushar's daughter is the orphan girl. So the locations are PM Road, Bharat Mata Theatre, Lal Bagh, Old Drive-In Theatre, Bandra, Bandra Kurla Complex, Dharavi Potter's Colony, and also this Gorai Beach. So what is very interesting is that all these locations were very kind of contested sites, you know, because all of them had, in fact, literally, so all of them had court cases going on. So when I was shooting there, either there was a protest going on or they didn't want me to come there because there was a court case. The Old Drive-In Theatre, by the way, has been destroyed. It's in what is called the BKC or the Bandra Kurla Complex. So this is 70s cinema, which and there's this glass-faced, this is the new Bombay that's coming up in its place. Maker Max City is the new Bombay. He allowed me to shoot. He's actually a collector. It's got these typical glass-faced blocks, offices. Bharat Mata Cinema has a very interesting history. It was set up in the 1930s and in the working class district of Lal Bagh, and to cater to the textile workers of Bombay. And it was called Lakshmi Cinema or something earlier, but I think during the Quit India movement in the 1930s, the name was changed to Bharat Mata. In fact, there's a line of them called Bharat Mata, Hind Mata, and so on. And it only shows Marathi films. So, in fact, I think the lease had got over or something at that point when I was shooting. I got permission for through Majlis and so on. And I think the textile workers and the MNS and a whole lot of people were actually protesting. There was a sit-down strike outside. Because they said this is the only theatre continuously showing Marathi films and it should not be destroyed. Anyway, it's still there. Then this PM Road is a typical Bombay art office. You will see sights of it. That's the villain's hangout. And Dharavi, of course, is very cinematic because of all the documentary films shot there. But of course, Slumdog Millionaire. So when I went there, these people were very fed up. They said, because after Slumdog, I think there's slum tourism, and every week apparently a crew comes from Europe wanting to shoot over there. So they're really fed up. Besides that, there's this whole redevelopment plan there. So again, there's a court case going on, and but anyway, they realized that I was not coming with the crew. It was just few of us, and it was just still photography. So they were fine. In fact, I shot in the Potter's Colony over there, which I also like to have a subjective sort of relationship to things, you know. So when I lived in Bombay and I was doing sculpture, I actually worked, I got my, terracotta sculptures fired in the Potter's Colony in Dharavi. So I had been there before and I chose that to shoot. And I included he's one of the characters, the potter over there is one of the characters. Oh, one sec. And Gorai Beach is again a contested site because in fact, Tushar told me because he said there was a fisherman's agitation over there because they wanted to make an SEZ over there. That's a special economic zone and the local people were protesting against it. So what I do is I weave a sort of fantasy, you know, it's not obvious in the thing, it's a kind of underlying sort of a thing in the work. So there's no text, it's a series of pictures, it's a kind of very abbreviated sort of, so this is the photo romance. And I've done many photo romances. Of course, it's a very popular form which you find in magazines, and it's seen as a very kind of it's seen as a cheap women sort of literature or form internationally. But I find it very interesting to use because I can use the kind of narrative with photography. This is the drive-in theater, Introduction to the Phantom Lady. This is this office in PM Road. What I liked about it is it's very small, but in all the walls have mirrors. And I've shot this in the film noir style, and one of the characteristics of film noir is this kind of reflections. So it was very interesting, the kind of images that came out. So I'm doing something nefarious, stealing some documents or something. So I'm playing this investigator and I get caught up with the land mafia. This is an orphan girl. My friend is playing the dead body. With great difficulty, I found someone to play the dead body. This is in the drive-in theater. So I also weave the scenes around the locations. I see the locations first and then I see what I can do. This is interesting because in front is the drive-in theater and at the back is the BKC, the maker towers coming up, and then there's construction or destruction going on in the middle. So there's a chase sequence over there. These are old projectors which are packed up in the drive-in theater. And if you, it's a kind of reference to this Chaplin's The Kid. There's a similar scene on the poster. In Dharavi, they were actually firing the kilns when I shot, the day I shot. So what was interesting is when I was shooting in Bharat Mata Theatre, the new Marathi film was released, and that was Natrang. So this it was about Tamasha in Maharashtra, which is the popular folk form of Maharashtra. So I found it very interesting, you know, these kind of layers coming in where there's this old Marathi theatre, and then, you know, there's film and cinema and theatre, you know, coming in into the work. So I got them to project a sequence. In the projection room, I'm looking for a bomb. So I was wondering what scene I could do in the projection room, and I said, yeah, I'm looking for a bomb, and where could the bomb be? It should be in a film can, because these film cans are always lying around. So my friend Tushar made me this bomb, which is in the film can, so I find that. This is the theater itself. Gorai Beach. Dharavi is a hideout. Gorai Beach, he sail away. New dawn. So this is again a very recent work. I just showed it last year. It's based on three women from the Ramayana. This came out of a show that I was invited for, but finally didn't happen. But I got very interested in the Ramayana and started reading. And so then I thought, what could my take be? So I decided to choose three incidents, key incidents involving three important women. That is Kaikeyi, Shurpanakha, and Sita. So this is, and I used the language of early theater. In fact, Rustam's very interested in this. So all the theatre people are very interested in this work. So the first section is called Chala, Intrigue. That's Taiki and the Mantra. So I've just taken an incident and sort of stretched it out. They're very large photographs actually. Indrajala Seduction is the cutting of the nose of Shurpanakha by Lakshmana. Apaharana Abduction is, of course, the abduction of Sita. So again, various friends act to them. So these are very elaborate with painted backdrops. Yeah, this friend who acts like the hunchback, sort of evil hunchback, made Mantara as a very, a friend of mine was very beautiful, so it's with great difficulty we made her look like an old hag. So I love these. I use a lot of orientalist elements in my work. This kind of odalisque, you know. So there's this kind of gramophone and this kind of very hybrid sort of thing of these Victorian elements which you see in company theatre. Find it very interesting. So this very Western sort of theatre kind of elements, like the Western curtains and. So she's intriguing how to get her way, checkmating Ashrata. The famous scene of the anger room. He decides to go to war. These are also very large, 4 feet and 5 feet. Actually, this is an interesting reference. I recreated this scene from an early Kannada play of Gubbi Veeranna's. Gubbi Veeranna Theatre. Well, Gubbi Theatre was the earliest company, most famous company theatre in Kannada, Karnataka. And his most famous role was that of this thief. It's nothing to do with the Ramayana. It's a kind of just a kind of tale. And but this particular pose, he kidnaps a woman, you know. So I just took this pose. So I love to make these kind of. It's very playful also, you know, as kind of different kinds of histories. And if you know it, like, it's very recognizable, but even otherwise, it's very kind of interesting, the image. And I've used the smoke machine in the work, which in fact my photographer suggested, which gives them all, I think, a very magical sort of air. I wanted this kind of very magical sort of mythical air about the whole thing. And several of them, yeah, this is also a reference from, I think, Pusa's painting of Rape of the Saban Women. I was seeing these characters actually archetypal figures and connecting them to other kinds of stories, because throughout the world's mythologies you find very similar stories. Like the story of abduction particularly is extremely archetypal, you know, you find it throughout sort of Greek mythology, like whether it's Helen of Troy or abduction of Europa or so many different kind of tales. And it's also like it changes the whole story, you know, it changes the whole world in a sense. So you find that having, it's a very key sort of sequence, and down to the present day, I think, it's a kind of, it's also an element of war, and it was one of the forms of marriage as well. So it's got this very interesting sort of history. This is also a kind of reference to Ravi Verma's Death of Jatayu. And this is refers to, it also reference a recreation of this fusilli, Henri fusilli. The Mrigayati, the hunt, I gave them all very classical names, and it's a stop motion video, like it's a video made from still photographs. Okay, this is a silent video. This is called Indrajala or Seduction, and it's about Shurpanakha. Yeah, so you can see that I've used a lot of references from early silent cinema, Dada Saheb Phalke and all that. I love this kind of very clumsy kind of animation and so thank you.
Thank you so much, Pushpamala ji. As you've seen that she's we've seen the exhibition yesterday by Vivan, you know, a retake of Amrita, and hers is probably a retake of, you know, many movements in the history of Indian cinema, Indian painting, and, you know, being herself the artist and the protagonist, and liberating probably either herself or women, lot of India, or maybe the mythological characters she is, you know, referring to in her presentation. God knows, maybe the gods and goddesses probably need to be liberated more than us, or we need to liberate ourselves of them. There are multiple layers of, you know, experiences which she's sharing with us. As we all know, she is a very, very well-known, very, very well, you know, respected artist of the country. And in this part of the country, we have seen for the first time a work which is, you know, shown all over the world, but here. We are so much thankful to you, Pushpamala, for coming over here. We've been actually wanting to have you here, but this week has really given us an opportunity to have a look at your work. We wish this was a longer presentation. Because of the design of the program, we had to, you know, keep it a little shorter, but we'll definitely request you to come again to give a longer presentation, maybe do a workshop with the artists of the city. Thank you once again. Thank you.